But hey, Titanic, a lot of correspondence came in about the film.
Quite a popular film in 1997. People might have caught a bit of it.
I haven't caught any of it.
You're one of those people that hasn't seen the Titanic, Ando.
Where it's one of those films that you, when you say you haven't seen it, people don't believe you.
Yeah.
You get responses like this. You're joking. You're joking. You haven't seen it.
You go, who's he talking about? 40 plus?
You go, well, no, I'm not joking. If it was, it's not a great joke. I have seen it.
Gotcha, guys. I've seen it 2.5 times.
But yeah, people perplexed by the fact, obviously, a very popular film, won awards, etc. It defined Leonardo DiCaprio's career in some respects.
I think it's because people feel almost like it was, it's just one of those films that's like it's on the curriculum. Mm. Like you have to see it. It's sort of like if you're turning up to the English exam and you tell me on the way and I haven't read the book, you'd be like, mate, what are you doing? You've got no chance in life now.
You're joking.
Of course you've read the book. Of course you've seen Titanic. But you haven't.
No.
So enough's enough. After all these years of people making brilliant Titanic references all around you, just having a huge laugh at your expense, it's time to catch you up on what happens.
And for all those people out there that have been lying, because, I just lie and say I've seen it.
You know the gist.
You know the gist.
Well, obviously, you know the end.
Yeah, exactly. So for all those people who've been lying, Hamish is about to give us, I hope, no more than a 2.5-minute synopsis.
I'm going to do my best.
Catch me up on
I've only seen
Titanic.
It once, so I'm having to cast my mind back about 16 years.
Sure.
Do you want the bit about the old woman? Because, to be honest, like, the film's technically a flashback, but it's a 2.5-hour flashback.
I don't know. Do I want the bit about the old woman?
Well, Jack's telling me no. Jack's giving me, 'cause the thing is, it's set in modern day, technically. They're exploring the wreck. Okay. They find it. Oh, actually, here we go. I'm in it. I think you're getting the old woman bit. They're exploring the wreck. They're looking for something. They're looking for a jewel. They bring up the safe of the fancy, you know, in modern, the year 2000, whatever. They bring up the safe to the surface on this exploration boat. They open up the safe in there, and the jewel's not in there. But they're like, oh, we did all this research. It should have been in there.
Yeah, right.
This amazing sapphire.
Yeah. It's Jackie's
like for a 3-hour movie, we're literally getting it play by play at the moment.
I want you to know this bit because this is the biggest quote. You'll appreciate
150
this.
Seconds.
You'll appreciate this bit, Ando. Okay. All they get is this picture of a girl wearing the jewel. So they're like, what's going on here? Yeah, that's in the safe, just this sketch.
Yeah.
Anyway, old woman's watching the TV. She goes, I know that. Yeah. Flies out to meet the research people, and they go, do you know the picture? The woman in the picture? And she says, the girl in the picture was me. At the start. Then she tells them the story of Titanic.
Okay.
Oh, wow.
So DiCaprio is just a scumbag. He's on the wharf.
Okay.
He wants a ticket on the ship, wins one gambling, just makes it on board.
Yeah.
He's a peasant. He's in the rubbish bit.
Yeah.
Kate Winslet is a fancy woman. She's in the expensive bit, first class.
They're different classes.
It's all very exciting. They set off. Everyone's like, this is the best boat. It'll never sink.
Yeah.
Winslet's unhappy. Almost goes to jump off the back of the boat. DiCaprio charms her. Talks her back over.
Because she doesn't like the...
Probably this is exciting music again.
Because she doesn't like her husband.
She hates her husband, who's Billy Zane.
Oh, right.
But not playing himself. He rarely does.
He's also acting.
Yeah, he's acting. In Zoolander he's not, but in this he's not playing himself. So she's a bit miserable. He talks her back over and she goes, look at this, I'm got everything in the world but I'm miserable. You're scum, but you're happy.
Yeah.
And he just sort of goes, that's sort of the way life goes. Sometimes I'm an artist who's been to Paris.
Yeah.
And they fall in love, essentially they have a bit of a kiss.
Oh, that's nice.
But forbidden love.
Yeah.
I think he gets invited to dinner at some stage. There's some sort of dinner situation.
Hang on, so he's coming from... He's up...
Well, she goes, listen, to the husband, this guy saved my life. Billy Zane goes, whatever, come to dinner on the fancy deck.
Ah, right, so he's bought into a better lifestyle.
Yep.
Like marrying a footballer.
No, just for a one-off. Like, going to go to the...
Sure.
We are running fiercely long here, aren't we? All right. Well, then, they dance with some Irish people. He takes her out for a date, but obviously they're on a boat, so there's not many places you can take her. So he takes her down to the Irish...
Leo does.
Leo takes Winslet downstairs to the scumbag class and dances with the Irish people.
And her husband doesn't realise this.
He's having brandy and cigars. Jack, I'm doing this as fast as I can. Stop wrapping me up. She realises, hang on a sec, poor people have a great quality of life. They're having a lot of fun. Mm. Hang on, what's that? Iceberg.
Oh, no.
This is the bit we all know and love.
Yeah.
Boof, they hit an iceberg. Yeah. Filmed very well. It's... It really gives you a sense of being there on the iceberg. They're doing a lot of running around trying to save each other. Sorry, Jack. They had had sex in a car.
Really?
Any music will do there, Jack.
I thought it was nice.
He went harder than that. Dude, put the Irish music on for sex. Yeah.
Sorry.
Leo's really... Took it down to the, it's sort of like Spirit of Tasmania. There was a car level. Not many cars back in 1912.
Right, so it wouldn't have keys.
Anyway, so sorry, Jack. Yeah. Back to the iceberg.
Yeah.
Just letting you know, that's happened. So they've done it. They're in love. There's a lot of, pretty much everyone's dying. They go in the water. It's bloody freezing. Mm. Long story short, they end up in the water. People are, there's not many lifeboats.
Yeah, just women and children.
People are freezing to death. It's pitch black. She's floating on a door, or they're both on a door. He gets off so it will float, and they're looking into each other's eyes. Spoiler alert, he slips away, dies. She survives, gets picked up. Cut back to present times. You realise the old woman is Kate Winslet.
Yep.
She
didn't she say that at the start?
Oh, yeah, you know that. But you go, oh, wow, what a life. He saved her life, and she's grown up to be old. And then at the end... Yeah. Hated this bit.
Yeah.
She's on the deck of the modern day ship. Pulls out the necklace. Yeah. She's still got it. Piffs it in the ocean.
Idiot!
You crazy old woman! Hey. Don't let old women on boats.
That's what I took
old
out.
Old women.
That's what I took out.
Two superstitions.
Hamish and Andy's happy hour.
Ando, topic today on the happy hour is airports. We've had a lot of different aspects of airports coming in. I'm going to give you the rundown in a second of Terminal.
Yes,
the Tom Hanks film. You've never seen it. I do pride myself on being able to explain a movie in a minute.
Well, it took longer than that.
Well, I'm going to try and get it in a minute. I'll give you the whole film.
I reckon you should change it to movie in minutes.
I like in a minute. It's like in a biscuit. Okay. In the meantime, Anna, can I just briefly read you a bit of correspondence here from Happy Chappy Dean. Went to hamishandandy.com/topics. He's coming to the show and he said, look, tells a tale of... The very first time he went on a plane, they had turbulence that was so bad that the guy next to him was writing his last words. He was scribbling frantically a note to his loved ones.
Wow.
It was that hairy. They landed, and his dad, who was with him at the time and well-traveled, said it was the worst plane ride he'd been on. And Dean was just like, you know, I'm not sure if I could ever fly again. He said, the crazy thing is, when I landed, I looked back, and I saw DJ Havana Brown and Andy Lee sharing a romantic wine in economy class. So that's a cool example of how you are calm in a crisis, and so is your woman. Thank you for the Andy Watch, Dean. Hashtag Andy Watch for all your sightings of Andy and DJ Havana Brown. Keep them coming in.
Look, today the topic is airports, everyone. And last week during the Titanic episode, I'd never seen the film, and you said you could just tell me the whole film within a couple of minutes.
Gave you a pretty good recap.
Yeah. So we had a request hamishandy.com/topics to do another one for the Terminal, obviously airport related, starring Tom Hanks.
Starring Tom Hanks, Ando, did not receive any Academy Award nominations for this film.
No.
And probably rightly so.
I've never seen it.
You haven't seen it. I've seen it at least once. It sticks in my mind.
Okay.
Well, not all of it sticks in my mind. Here we go. You ready, Andy, for your movie in a minute?
Well, in minutes, yes. And
I'll try and get it under a minute.
I don't think you'll succeed. But yeah, for anyone who hasn't seen the film The Terminal and you want to see it, don't listen to this bit. But
this is the other thing. When I do movie in a minute, I'll usually do one that's at least 5 years old. So you can't have a go at me for spoiling it. If you wanted to see it, you would have seen it.
But at least it's going to catch everyone up if they haven't seen it, like myself. So
you ready?
Take it away, yeah.
All right. So Tom Hanks lands on a plane.
Lands
at the airport on a plane.
Oh, yeah, cool.
I can't remember his character, but...
He's in the plane.
Oh, yeah, and it lands. How's the time count, Jack?
Just over halfway.
And then the rest of the film happens. Now, he gets there, and He's coming from a country that's war-torn. From memory, it's a fictional country. Sounds something like Albania. Mm-hmm. Not Albania, though. So we'll call it Albania. It's a war-torn country. While he's in the air, the country has been wiped off the map. They've lost. Wow. They've lost the war, and Russia or whatever has now just absorbed them. He gets to customs, and they sort of go to him, look, your country doesn't exist. We can't let you into the United States from a country that doesn't exist.
Yeah.
So he goes...
Are these centipedes taken from the actual film?
Yeah, okay. We're playing snippets of the film here. He sort of goes, this is a bummer. He's sort of got a Borat-y type accident, okay. Accent, yeah. And he sort of goes, oh, no, what? You know, he's a family man. He's a gentle guy. I think he might have even been an engineer on a conference. Okay. So he goes, well, I don't know what to do. And they go, you can't come in, but we can't send you back to a country that doesn't exist. So you're stuck at the airport. So then... He sees that there's a part of the airport that's under construction, and it turns out that he's a tiler. Yeah. And so he just sort of starts tiling with them. Doesn't speak much English, but is just sort of using his kind of Albanian vibes. Again, not Albanian.
Non-Albanian.
I think it's a made-up country.
Albanian-ish vibe.
He's sort of using those vibes to show the guys the way he does it in his country, and everyone's really appreciating that from a tiling perspective. So for this bit of the film, it's more of a tiling film. Catherine Zeta-Jones is a woman who is flying around the place. She's a businesswoman. He sees her and...
falls in love with her.
Yeah. But how does he get around her? He's stuck in the no man's land between the gate and customs, and he's just a tiler.
She be coming past for, 2 hours max.
She brushes him off.
Yeah.
But does look back, and there's a glint in her eye.
Yeah.
So then he's there. Days pass, weeks pass. Planes are flying overhead.
Yeah.
He goes, how do I win her over? And he makes her a great piece of tiling. It's a montage. He sort of does this through the night.
Hang on. Stop that. How come she's back again?
She's always travelling.
Oh, okay, so he sees her regularly because it's her regular route.
Now you get it.
Okay, yeah, sure.
So he's made her that
okay.
mosaic.
Yeah,
he's
sure.
made her this cool mosaic.
Yeah.
He's got a bit of a standoff with a customs official.
Yeah.
It looks like he's going to get out.
Yeah.
He doesn't. But on the plus side, yeah. he does hook up with Zeta-Jones. I think in the Dunnies.
Really?
I've heard people say that...
Maybe. I think they go for it...
too much of anything.
I'm not sure if
in the toilet.
I don't think that would happen.
And then I think she adopts him.
I don't know about that.
You don't remember the end of this film, do you?
She adopts him, and he becomes a U.S. citizen, so she
adopt.
Takes him out.
It's not true.
She sort of, I guess she Angelina Jolie's him, and then I think he goes to live with it. So that's the terminal.
That's the happy hour.
In a minute. What was the time? 58 seconds.
Dude, this is exciting for me. Mm. For those who've seen it before, I mean, it's a good way to see it again, but we're talking about movie in a minute. Haim, you think you can pretty much give everyone the entire, not just the gist of a film,
yep.
the entire film experience.
All the ups and downs.
In 1 minute. It came about when I told you that I hadn't seen Titanic. You said, are you joking me?
Yeah.
And now today I said I hadn't seen Castaway.
And I absolutely smashed it out of the park with Titanic. Mm. There was some Irish jig music.
Yeah.
Had it all.
I can't remember what we did in the middle as well. We have done two of these.
Have we done another one?
Yeah.
We did The Terminal as well. Another Tom
Hanks film. Tom Hanks.
Another Tom Hanks film.
Yeah, that's right. The Terminal.
And we're at Castaway again. As you can see, I specialised in seeing big-budget films between about 1997 and 2004.
Yeah.
That was my real peak period.
Yep.
And Castaway was a wonderful film, an epic film. I believe Hanks got an Oscar nod for it. I don't think he won.
I thought he did.
No, I'm pretty sure he's just won for Gump and Philadelphia. There are his two Oscars.
Really? Because I thought there was a back-to-back in there.
Yeah, I think that might have been Gump and Philadelphia.
Yeah, right.
But it doesn't matter. It's still a bloody good film. The thing is, it's him for almost the whole film, just by himself on an island. But spoiler alert, not going to give too much away.
Okay.
You don't need to know anything.
No.
Jack and I have just been...
If you were planning to watch it this weekend and don't want to know the film...
Oh, this will sink Blockbuster.
Yeah.
Because I know it's still one of their popular rentals and no one's going to hire it after this. And prepare to go into the world of Castaway, the film. The film opens in Russia. It's pretty happy.
Okay.
Tom Hanks works for FedEx.
Oh, so mail related.
Mail related.
Yeah.
And he is mail for the whole film. just a lot of running around in Russia. He's working at the FedEx office. Little kid comes in with a package that's been delivered. Hanks opens it up and pulls out, amongst other things, a stopwatch and stops the clock. It's about 30 hours. He goes, this is the kind of delivery. He sent it from America to Russia. So it's like a bit of a, that's how long it took to get here. The gist is, he's great at what it does. He does at FedEx. Then the holidays are coming up. So he goes, mind if I hitch a ride on the FedEx plane? The guys go, yeah, no worries. There's just one other seat on the plane. We'll take you back to America. He says,
Jack, what could possibly go wrong?
No, he doesn't.
All words to the effect.
Okay, sure.
Unfortunately, as they're flying, something bad does go wrong. Mm-hmm. There's a plane crash. And the plane crashes into the ocean. Way off course.
Oh, no.
And Hanks washes up on the beach alone and with only a few scraps from the plane. Mm-hmm. A couple of FedEx bits and pieces, you know, a life jacket, not much.
Pretty amazing survive.
Yeah, it was great. Yeah. He tries to get water from a coconut.
Okay.
He does,
yeah.
But it takes ages. One of the things that washes up is a volleyball from the plane.
Okay.
I'm going to call you Wilson.
He calls it Wilson because it's a Wilson brand volleyball.
Yeah.
Look, he a long time spent on the island. He realizes he's hopelessly alone. His beard grows to almost belly button length. Mm-hmm. Very long beard.
Huge beard.
Yeah.
Look, eventually, though, he sort of gets jack of the island and goes, this is it. No matter what, I'm going to try and get off the island, even though there's a very sharp reef. He makes a raft and heads out into the ocean. At one stage, he gets washed off his raft. He loses the volleyball.
Well, the music would be different for
that. Wilson!
Oh, that's right. Sad at that stage.
That's sad, yeah.
Then he sees a whale that he's distracted by.
All right.
And he realizes he's sort of out in a shipping channel. What's this? A Japanese ship. Meets comes out. No, what's that, Jack?
He's put his right hand up, which
Jack,
means music.
Music change.
Sorry.
What was that other sound effect? It sounded like a machine gun.
Great.
Japanese fishing ship.
Yeah.
He's been rescued. Bearing in mind, we're about 2 hours into the film now. This is pretty much the end of the film.
Okay.
Gets rescued. Gets taken back to civilization. Yeah. I think his wife's actually hooked up with someone else.
Oh, no.
Music change, Jack. Which is sad.
That is sad.
So that's a bit of a blood.
Yeah.
But he's had
he's
had this he's had this one package, this FedEx package, the whole time that he didn't open.
Because
he was like, I'm a FedEx delivery guy.
Yeah.
I must survive to deliver this package. Mm. And he finds out who it was for. And he goes goes over to her house. Might even be Helen Hunt.
Yeah.
Could be Helen Hunt. Can't remember.
I think it is, because I've seen just
that might have been his wife, actually.
All right, sorry.
But then at the end, he gives the girl the package.
Here's your package.
Yeah.
And I think I might be in love with you.
Hang on.
Not
actually,
sure.
I think just here's your package.
Oh.
Can't remember if he falls in love with her or not. It might. And then I think the final shot's just him out at her farm.
Yeah.
And he's just sort of, you know, good to be home.
Yeah,
good to be back on the roller.
Yeah,
that's pretty much it. There's a little bit there. It gets a bit dark on the island, but don't worry about that.
Hey, and from time to time we do movie in a minute. This one's got a twist.
Movie in a minute.
Not the opener.
It does have a bit of a twist, Ando, because I'm going to present to you Jaws, a quick synopsis of Jaws using dialogue, music, and action from the film in 1 minute.
Well, it kind of goes against the purpose of the segment. The segment was to get me up to speed on a film I haven't seen within a minute. One that you normally have seen, and you can give me the whole gist.
We've had great success before. Castaway was a ripper. You hadn't even seen Titanic. Now you kind of have, because I gave you Movie in a Minute.
But you haven't even seen Jaws, and you don't.
But I feel like I have, because it's such a classic film, and you always see highlights. And
okay, do you want me to just wait till the end before jumping in to tell you whether you were wrong or right about this one? Because I have.
Do you remember it?
Yeah.
I was hoping you might not remember it too much. Well, I mean, a lot of people haven't seen Jaws, so it's not just between you and me.
So you want feedback at the end or at the beginning?
Look, give it to me at the end, because I'll be in a real rhythm.
Okay.
Because I'm always trying to get in under a minute. I've never missed my benchmark.
So this is what Hamish believes Jaws to be.
I think I've seen enough of the, you know, classic moments of
Take
film
it away.
Clip shows. Okay, movie in a minute, Jaws. Warren is the main character. He's a humble fisherman. He has two kids, Shirlene and Brody. He also has a brother, Norm. Norm is also a fisherman. They live in a fishing town on the coast.
We love you, Dad. I love you, kids. We love you, Uncle Norm. Oh, don't get too attached to me.
Rightly so. Right, fair enough that Norm would say that.
Yeah, right.
Because word spreads of a massive shark lurking off the coast. Yeah. That's the Jaws music.
Yeah, okay, that bit's true.
Uncle Norm is out fishing with one of the kids, I think it's Shirlene, and Jaws attacks, and Uncle Norm gets eaten whilst trying to save one of the kids' lives.
Yeah, I don't think we
that's a kid falling in who's safe. And then, yeah, Uncle Norm's dead.
Okay.
So that becomes quite sad. That's sort of act one of the film. Okay. So Warren, the main character, is like, that's it. I've had it up to here with this shark.
Okay, yeah.
I've got to go out there. And then the kids are all like, Dad, don't.
What, he's going to go out there and get
avenge
it?
This shark's eating his brother.
Yeah, sure.
So Warren's like, I'm fed up. I've had it to pussy's bow with this shark. And the kids are like, don't do it, Dad, because it's already got Norm.
Okay.
And then Warren's like, don't you get it? That's exactly why I do have to go out there.
Okay.
Because Norm and I swore it back to his children that if one of us ever got eaten by a shark, the other one would avenge the death. So I do have to go.
I'm waiting for feedback at the end of it, right? Yeah.
So he takes his boat out. Yeah. He's yelling like it's a storm. Middle of the day storm. And he's yelling, come and get me, Jaws. Come and get me.
Okay, doesn't happen. Yep.
Very much like Lieutenant Dan yells in the storm in Forrest Gump. Then it turns into sunny weather. Jaws appears.
Yep.
There's a lot of babes running out of the surf. I think I remember there being babes in the film. There might be a babe on the boat as well. Then Jaws, it's just on. Jaws is trying to chomp up the boat.
Yep.
Might just chuck a chomp in there if you want, Jack. Jaws is trying to chomp up the boat.
Yep.
Eventually, through a bit of... Jaws also eats a big apple. Eventually, through a bit of foxing, Warren throws a gas tank into Jaws' mouth, shoots it with a flare gun, blows Jaws up, also blows up most of the boat. Yeah. But Jaws is dead, even though the boat's blown up. Warren, he's fallen off his chair with acknowledgement of how accurate this is. Warren swims back to the beach, and he puts on a massive feast with all of Jaws's flesh and also with the
flake
boat.
Flake with, for all.
And then he yells out,
hey, did anyone order flake with minimum ship?
Because the boat was blown into smithereens. Credits roll.
Well, where to begin? There's no Warren. There's no Norm. The main character's Brody.
Is it?
Yeah.
So I have one of the kids. One of the kids was called Brody.
Yeah.
So that's pretty good.
It's not pretty good.
Pretty amazing.
He does die that way.
And you, Jaws, died that way.
But, I mean, I don't want to go through and explain it.
Does the main character's brother get eaten?
No.
Should have.
Thought
that added a nice emotional revenge part.
If you haven't seen The Sixth Sense, that's another film we're going to concentrate on because people often spoil that film.
Oh, spoiler alert for The Sixth Sense. It's coming up next. I'm going to do a movie in a minute.
Yeah.
This is where I recap a film in 60 seconds, no more.
No, it seems to go for a lot longer.
And Andy,
normally.
It's always a film that Andy hasn't seen in the past. We've done Titanic, we've done Castaway.
I haven't seen The Sixth Sense, so.
Oh, I have, about 11 years ago. But I remember it perfectly, Andy, which is why I can recap it in movie in a minute.
Spoilers. We're talking today.
We are, Ando.
And a lot of people, I think I know the end of this film already because it seems to me it's the one film that everyone knows the end of, even if they haven't watched it. It's a spoiler-heavy movie. The film is The Sixth Sense.
When it came out in 2002...
It mightn't be that. It mightn't be that.
Might have been 98.
Well...
Doesn't matter. When it came out, at the time, everyone would go, have you seen The Sixth Sense? You'd go, no. And they'd be like, oh, I'm not going to tell you the ending. And then everyone... Like, it was the whole thing, like, don't tell anyone the ending. Because that was the pivotal part of the film.
It was 99, Jack's telling us.
It was 99. Yeah. Well done. So... Now, so what do you think the ending is?
Well, I mean, we're allowed
to spoil it.
You're allowed to spoil this now because it's 15 years.
It's close to 20.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, it's 15.
So, the guy, Bruce Willis, was dead the whole time.
Okay, so you know that bit, but...
I've never seen the film, though.
So much else to the film.
Yeah.
Okay, do you give me permission to give you one of my patented movie in a minute?
Love to. Love to hear it.
Which is where I try and condense a 100... and 13-minute film, as The Sixth Sense was, down into a measly 60 seconds, Ando.
Go for it.
I've done Titanic for you.
Yep.
I've done Castaway. I feel like we did another one too, another Tom Hanks film.
Terminal.
That was a cracker. Are you ready, Jay?
Sixth Sense goes for 107 minutes.
Oh, so I added six for good luck.
Not bad.
Thank you. Start the clock, Jay. Okay, so Haley Joel Osment, little kid, moves into a new neighborhood because his dad gets fired.
Okay.
Or sent to work in this new neighborhood. Yeah. Long story short, it just seems like a crappier neighborhood than he was in before. And as the truck drives off, Haley Joel Osment's dad's like,
"What do you think, son?"
But Haley Joel Osment's like, "I've seen better neighborhoods. It looks like a pretty spooky old house." Okay. And he walks inside and suddenly floor creak. Okay. Sort of sets the tone for the film. Now, it's school holidays, I think, at the time. Or he's taking a little break before he starts up school because I don't remember him going to school.
Okay.
And he doesn't have any kid friends around.
Okay.
So he just sort of goes to a sort of a spooky park nearby and swings on some swings by himself. And that's very much sort of, you get picking up on the tone, aren't you?
Yeah, sure.
So Bruce Willis is at the park and he sees him and he sort of goes over to Haley Joel Osment and goes, "You know, no friends, huh?" And Haley's like, yeah. And then Bruce is like, "Listen, we can hang out if you want. I'm not weird or anything." And Haley goes, "Yeah, okay. But my parents obviously will be weird about this because you're an old man and I'm a little boy. So we can hang out, but just
keep it on the download.
Like, I accept your deal, but yeah, you stay out of sight
around
my parents." And then Bruce Willis is like,
"Can do, kid."
So he agrees to that deal.
Okay, cool.
Anyway, Haley goes home and then he's upstairs at his spooky house and he sees an old maid from like the 1700s there.
All right.
And she turns to him and says,
"Serve you some soup, sir."
No, she doesn't.
And he's like,
"Have you seen this film, Jack?"
Hang on. Yeah. This is it. Don't.
Okay, sure.
I've only got a minute. So then Haley goes, "That's weird." Goes downstairs and goes to his parents, "I just saw an old maid upstairs who offered to serve me some soup." The parents go, "That's impossible. You know, the house is securely fenced and locked." And what door did she come out of? And he tells them, no one's ever been out of that door for 100 years. There's a locked door. So suddenly we're going, what's going on here? Then he goes and talks to Bruce Willis and Willis goes, "Yeah, that was a ghost."
He goes, I'm
a little bit more open-minded than your parents. Yeah. That was a ghost. So then Haley goes home and goes into the kitchen and he sees an old circus master who's in the kitchen who says,
"Sell you a ticket to the circus once you've had your soup, boy."
And then Haley goes, "I know what's going on here." Yeah. So he calls his parents in and drops the catch line of the film.
"I see dead people."
And then his parents go, "We call them ghosts, but yes. You've lost it."
You've lost it.
Yeah. Okay, well, so that's basically getting worried about it.
Good parents.
Anyway, they go, "We're worried about you."
Sure.
And he goes, "Well, I've got something else to tell you. I've only got 15 seconds left." He goes, "I've got something else to tell you. I've also been hanging out with Bruce Willis a lot, and I've been connecting with him because I don't have any childhood friends." "Get in here, Bruce." Bruce is waiting outside. Yeah. Bruce comes in and says,
"Howdy, gang."
And then the parents go, "There's no one there. What are you talking about? You've lost it." Then they leave. Haley turns to Bruce and goes, why couldn't they see you?" And then the penny drops for Haley and he goes, "Son of a bitch, you..."
No, he doesn't. He's a small kid. He wouldn't
"You
have sworn.
Are also a ghost. Yeah. Why didn't you tell me you were a ghost?" And Willis, the final scene of the film, Willis says,
"Sorry, kid. Didn't want to spoil the movie for you."
So happy now.
And the audience rises as one, cheering.
And we've just heard Hamish's patented movie in a minute, where he was meant to describe the film The Sixth Sense.
Mate, I think I did a pretty good job.
Well,
got it in under a minute.
The point is, and if you missed it, please go get the podcast at hamishandandy.com or at iTunes. But the thing is, the point of this segment was, you've seen a film that you remember very well, and you explain it to me in as quickly as you possibly can.
I try to.
That didn't seem quite right. Now, first of all, Jack, you've seen the film, have you?
I've seen it a long time ago, but I have enough of a memory of it to know that none of that was right.
Okay, so you said
that a lot of that happens in the film.
You said he met Bruce Willis in a park. Oh, is that what happened?
Like that. I feel like they hung out at a park once.
Well, he wasn't just being a creepy old man to him. Bruce Willis was his therapist.
Ring a bell now. Sure.
Well, that's an important part.
Oh, mate, I can't remember every film I've ever seen.
But are his parents taking him to the therapist?
Well, you're as an audience member, you're meant to think that their parents know about Bruce Willis at the whole time.
This sounds less plausible than the film I described.
Well, anyway, and then hang on,
at the end, Haley Joel Osment works out that Bruce Willis is dead.
Right.
But Bruce Willis didn't even know he was dead himself.
How? So he's going through.
How is there ghosts?
How do you not know you're dead?
So
I think my film was a lot smarter.
So Haley Joel Osment spoils it for Bruce
in a way. Yeah, Rex.
He tells him
didn't Bruce's daughters die or something? Didn't Bruce have kids that like he wanted to hang around and he was looking?
No, getting huge shakes of the head. Huge shakes of the head. Yeah. Do you think in the future?
I'm positive. I've seen it. I just obviously didn't. I mean, it just didn't stick.
So how does Bruce take the news that he's dead? In your version, Ham, you had him saying,
"Sorry, I didn't want to spoil it for
you." You know, he was dead. He claimed, but he finds out. How does he take it, Jack, when he finds out he's dead?
Wasn't he just standing in a hallway and he like just lets it wash over?
Now that sounds familiar to me. Okay. There's a hallway.
There's a hallway and a set of stairs. There's quite a lot that happens on a set of stairs.
The only thing accurate so far is the environment Bruce once stood in.
Yeah. The ghosts, and there are a few ghosts that he talks to in the movie. None of the ghosts are as Hamish described.
There was no circus ghosts. There was no old maid. Okay, we're gonna have to review. Gonna have to review this.
Listen, I don't pick what films we do movie in a minute for.
No.
It has to be something that you haven't seen and I have. Yeah. Yes, I would like it to be a film I watched last night.
Yeah.
But that's not always going to happen, unfortunately. You have seen Passenger 57, yeah. And that's a film I watched last night. So I'm just getting a bit stuck where sometimes it's a film that I've seen a very long time ago. I think my Titanic one was excellent. Guys, it's almost impossible to match what you just created in here for a moment, but I'm going to try with something I promised on the show.
Yes, for people who haven't listened to this show ever, welcome, by all means. But Hamish did, particularly last year, have a segment called Movie in a Minute. If he'd found a movie that I hadn't seen,
yep.
He can pretty much recreate it in a minute,
yep.
With some sound effects, and I get the gist of that film entirely.
And Andy doesn't have to see the film. Mm. Now, this is a very exciting one. Have we got any kids in here that like the movie Frozen?
Yeah!
A lot of kids,
yeah.
Well, guys, we're going to do Frozen, the movie, in a minute, except, little disclaimer, I watched this movie with my niece, Juno. It's her favourite film. She's 5 years old. But it was the night before my son's first birthday, and I had bought him a truck, like a little plastic truck that he can sit in. I was under the assumption it came assembled.
Yes.
And so I was getting the truck out of the box to kind of like put a ribbon on it, and I realised it required a hefty amount of assembly. So I was building a truck while Frozen was on. So
right.
I didn't really...
Oh, you had the like...
I was sort of dipping in and out
boy
of Frozen.
Thing and
but that won't matter, guys.
It doesn't matter. So this is Frozen to the best of my recollection from when I kind of dipped in and out of it. Now,
which is pretty much how all your movies
I'm
going to
try and keep
anyway.
It under a minute. Right. Delta, you're going to play Elsa. She's
okay,
one of the
you.
Girls from Frozen. Yes. Andy, don't get
let
too...
It go.
Don't get well. There's no singing
no
in
singing?
My one because
oh, okay.
I sort of I tuned
that song's
out.
Not in it, right?
Well,
right,
I tuned
okay.
out during the songs. I'll do the narration now, Jack.
You might have heard
Jack.
Some rustling before, but Cackling Jack's here with us. Welcome, Jack.
Thanks, guys.
Jack, you're sort of. I need you to do live sound effects.
Okay.
Now I know you would have preferred to see the script beforehand because quite a lot of it involves you setting the mood on a recorder, and it's not an instrument Jack can play. There's also later on.
Oh,
I need you to.
There's a nice little picture of Elsa.
It's actually a Frozen recorder, okay. Guys. Okay, start
so
the clock.
Here we go. Before we start the clock, this is Frozen to the best of Hamish's ability and recollection.
Yep.
Jack is going to be doing all live sound effects, and Delta
and
is playing
I've,
the character
I'm
of
Elsa.
I've just sort of handed scripts to Delta and Andy.
Yep.
You guys will have sort of small roles in the.
We
in
don't
the film
really
as well.
Have that much, do we?
That's all right.
Andy? It's okay. It's mostly narration because I've got to squeeze it in a minute.
I prefer
got it,
not
all
to
right.
be a part
yeah.
of these anyway.
Okay. Start the clock for 1 minute. Jack, play some enchanting music.
This is mine, right?
In a faraway land not too dissimilar to Mount Buller, there were two sisters. One had magic powers, able to shoot freezing bolts of cold from her hands, as represented by the super soaker that Delta is holding.
I'm Elsa.
Whoop. Don't squirt the narrator, Elsa. You...
Am I allowed to do that?
Yeah, well, you have.
I'm sorry, Hamish. I'm so sorry. Yes,
okay. Well, you're meant to be sort of squirting everyone.
I'm a method actor, guys. Okay, I'm in the moment. Just keep going.
That's not in the script, everybody, but Delta has...
So Elsa's squirting people. Andy, who are you?
I'm the quite plain, slightly tomboyish sister who has no powers.
That's right. There was another sister, and the plain sister's name is never mentioned in the film, to my knowledge. So, during some hijinks, Elsa shoots the plain sister in the heart.
I've been shot by the sister I love.
Soz.
Okay. So, the plain sister got frozen in the heart. No, but it wasn't good, but luckily the plain one is brought back to life by some Shrek-like characters who are trolls. That's you, Jack.
Okay, I'm the troll. Okay, we've brought the plain one back to life, but erased her memory. She won't know about Elsa, played by Delta Goodrum. She won't know about Elsa's powers, ever. It's a classic fairy tale trade-off.
I'm cool with that.
That's a great gag that actually doesn't appear in the film Frozen. Anyway, the girls grow up. And now, later in their life, they're both kind of babes.
I'm hot now.
Yes, but Elsa is overcome with being an adult or something, and her powers just freak out, and she runs away to a giant ice castle, leaving the whole kingdom frozen.
I'm confused about seeing her magic powers, and I also I'm in love with a prince.
That's right, the plain one has fallen in love with a prince, but he's a jerk. And mostly at this point the plain one sets off to find Elsa in the forest, and also she's with a guy that owns a reindeer.
Is that meant to be a moose sound effect?
That was half.
Yeah, it's a sheep toy.
Okay, well, I was hoping for at least a cow. Anyway, so from now on when you hear a sheep, that's a moose. We've got to keep going, the minute's running out.
Seems like it's gone a lot longer than a minute.
Also, here's something I do need to point out. I remember there was a silly little snowman in the film, but to be honest, I didn't see him that much as the poster and the merchandising would make out in terms of him being a character.
You won't hear from me anymore, not this snowman.
Jack's the snowman. So yeah, don't worry about the snowman, I've cut him out. So the plain sister and the reindeer guy go up to the mountains and there's an avalanche. That was the sound of some snow falling from one bucket to another bucket. But the avalanche, everyone's
sorry,
fine.
Sorry, just quickly for any people in their cars. Jack tried to pick up a bucket of snow and pour it into another bucket. It came up in one solid block and pretty much made no sound.
No noise for our live sound effect. Yeah. Anyway, everyone's fine from the avalanche, and the plane sister and the reindeer guy make it to the ice castle. Delta.
You found me.
Yep, they found her.
I've been an ice cold idiot.
No, don't jump ahead.
You jumped ahead.
Well, there's a lot more narration. There's a battle.
Hey guys, you found me.
There was a battle between some guys. I can't remember why they were there. That's a battle noise.
But everything's Jack.
Everything was fine, Andy. And Elsa sees she's being silly living in the ice castle. That's you, Delta.
I have been. I've been an absolute ice-cold idiot.
So anyway, the whole kingdom gets unfrozen at that point, and I think the plain one marries the reindeer guy, and I'm pretty sure the reindeer is the priest that marries them. And that's meant to be the noise of a reindeer. And that's Frozen, Andy.
Yes.
And what was that?
Now.
We got time on that?
You should totally see it, Andy.
59 seconds. 59 seconds.
I don't think Disney or whoever put this film together are going to use that as the best advertisement for the film, because I didn't follow it whatsoever.
Do you feel like you understood it?
I love it, mate.
Yeah. So that's Frozen in a minute, guys.
Haim, yesterday on the show, we were talking... I can't really remember what we were talking about, but...
I was talking about how in your replacement you can't pick and choose your assignments.
Yes.
Based on whether or not they'd have a personal benefit
or
for
emotional
you.
Connection. And I said, actually...
Well, you mentioned the film Die Hard with a Vengeance. For people that weren't listening, you said this.
Die Hard with a Vengeance. I think they realised that Samuel Jackson's kids were at the actual hot primary school, so they made the
jump
school.
In now and quickly tell you I haven't seen it. But I just thought, you know, for me and the rest of people that haven't seen it, you're doing a really specific... reference to a pretty old film. When did Die Hard with a Vengeance come out? 90s?
Probably, 1995.
Like, yeah, okay. There we go. Old, 20 years ago.
Yes, but I was explaining the reference. It wasn't like it was like, oh, like Die Hard with a Vengeance.
No, I know.
And then didn't have to go on with it. Like
now, it would have just required heaps of setup. And I think I was trying to blow something wide open too, I like to cut to the chase in that segment, so I don't like to be sidetracked.
Don't like to be, oh, yeah, I held back. okay, well, then you said, I said, well, why don't you go away? For anyone who hasn't seen Die Hard with a Vengeance, starring Bruce Willis, Samuel Jackson.
Yep.
Watch it.
And Jeremy Irons.
And... yes, Jeremy Irons is in it.
Yes, I know.
Okay. Why don't you go away, watch it, come back and do movie in a minute.
Yep.
Yep.
Now, you and I were out last night. Yep. We're on a flight. Then, you know, we're out to about sort of 10 o'clock. Then I had to go and see someone else. And so I didn't get home till... Probably didn't get home till about 11 last night. And yep. I remember walking in the door going, God, still got to watch Die Hard with a Vengeance. Maybe I just don't do it.
Yep.
I thought, no, I made a promise. Yep. I said I'd do it, and I bloody did it. Sat down.
Download it, did you? Or?
Rented on iTunes.
Okay.
So, because yeah. I'm not going to keep it.
How long
it.
Did it go for?
Felt like just under 2 hours. Felt like about 105 minutes, 110 minutes.
Okay. It's just over 2 hours, but that's all right.
Is it?
Yeah.
It flew. Well done, Bruce and Samuel. You've made a punchy film.
Yeah.
And it is a good film. But don't take my word for it.
Well, I have to, because you're about to tell us about it.
Yeah, I'm going to give you the whole synopsis here, using sound effects and the real 2D experience. Actually, 1D, both the dimensions of sound, but different versions within that D.
Okay.
So do you want to hear a movie in a minute?
Yeah.
Okay.
If you've seen it.
Yes, I have.
Okay.
Okay, well, here we go. Okay. I just thought we had an opener. We don't. Don't start the clock yet, Jack. Okay, get ready. Yeah. Start the clock. So, it's set in New York City, yes. Where a lot of the Die Hard franchise is set. As you said, it is the third. He's a New York City cop, John McCain.
No, but Die Hard, the first one was L.A.
Yeah, but he's a New York City cop. So, he's been a cop for a while.
Okay, keep going.
So, start the clock. So, he's, it's John, you know. John McCain.
Yes.
That's Bruce Willis's character. Yeah. He's a cop. terrorist attack. Something hits. On the street in New York.
Yeah.
Not good. Everyone's like, what's going on? What's going on? It comes out that this guy, someone wants to speak to him, John McCain. But he's like, man, I don't do that anymore. Yeah. I'm still a cop, but I'm not interested.
It's McClane.
I thought that sounded wrong. McClane.
So
he goes, you know what? I am still a cop. I got the badge. But I'm not really into this anymore. You know, why me? They go, look, it's, you know, don't know.
Yep.
Don't know, but this guy, he's got it in.
He didn't have a badge.
He's got it in. They've got it in for you.
Yep.
And so we're teaming you up with Samuel L. Jackson. And you guys... You've got to figure out who this is and what he's doing, because he's playing a game of cat and mouse with you. And he's giving him games like Simon Says Do This, Go Here.
Yeah.
And they're like, who's this guy, this mysterious guy? Then there's a phone ring and McClane's like, who's this? Bruce Willis goes, who's this? The guy goes, terrorist. Mm. He goes, what do you want? Terrorist goes, "Not. Why would I tell you? And McClane's like, well, don't do it. Whatever you're doing, don't do it. He goes, I'm going to do it. I'm going to keep playing with you. You've done it again. I said don't do it.
Yeah.
And then Willis is like, all right, now I'm going to get you.
Yep.
Like you've poked the bear.
Yep.
So he's like, let's go. Come on, Samuel Jackson. Let's get him.
Yeah.
that's the wrong sound. That's near the end, Jack.
Yeah. Okay.
So he goes to Samuel Jackson, you know, get your gun, get your stuff. Like, we don't have time.
Okay, Samuel Jackson doesn't have a gun. He is an innocent bystander. He's not even a cop.
No, but he's like, I deputise you now. You're a cop. Like, we both have to... Yeah, I'm deputising you. We both have to act like cops.
Yeah.
You're in it with me, no matter what.
Okay.
Sam Jackson's like, oh, man, you're a bit crazy, but this seems like fun. Let's go for it. So they solve a couple of riddles here and there, all the while quite intense.
Yeah.
Then it gets to the primary school bit, which we all know.
Yeah.
And that's where it looks like things are going to be terrible. But then Bruce Willis is like, Sam, get in the car with me. We're going to drive through Central Park. And they do a jump. Yeah. They do a jump out of Central Park.
Yeah.
And they're like, we got it. We got the terrorists. Out, and it came out that year on May 17th. If I remember correctly.
You've watched the trailer.
What? Cut him off, Jack. Get Andy off air.
Central Park happens in the middle of the film.
get Andy off air, because now he's gone mad.
You're off, Andy. The minute's up anyway. Just finished
then. I'm off.
So there you go. Movie in a minute. Yeah. Hope you enjoy it. Hope you loved it.
Tight minute.
59 seconds. PB.